Today I receive all of God's love for me. Today I open myself to the unbounded, limitless, overflowing abundance of God's universe. Today I open myself to God's blessings, healing, and miracles. Today I open myself to God's word, so I become more like Jesus every day. Today I proclaim that I'm God's beloved. I'm God's servant. I'm God's powerful champion. And because I am blessed, I am blessing the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Today we're going to start a brand new series, and you are going to be blessed by this. So
welcome everybody to our brand new series called Ascend. Ascend. Why ascend? You can write that down. This series will talk all about mountains. That's right. We are going up on the mountain, and we're going to ascend to the mountaintop, and we're all going to have a God encounter. But hey, don't worry, because you don't need to be a mountain climber or a trekker. You don't need to be in shape to do this. All you got to do is open yourself and receive God's word, all right, in the comfort of your own couch. Hallelujah. This will be a four-part series, and for each talk, we're going to explore four different mountains, okay? Today, we're going to explore this, Mount Eden. You're going to get shocked what mountain this is, okay? And then next Sunday, we're going to explore Mount Ararat and then Mount Moriah. And then lastly, on the fourth Sunday, we're going to go up to Mount Sinai. So here's my question. Are you ready to go on a four-week hiking trip? If you're ready, declare this and type this with me. I am going up. Come on, I am going up. Hallelujah. You see, mountaintops were actually a very significant place in the Bible. Why? Because it's the place where God met people. I mean, think about it. From Abraham to Moses to Elijah, all the way to Jesus, that's where God met them. But the question is, how come? Because according to the ancient worldview, which is practically the worldview of our biblical authors, you see, a mountain was the meeting point between heaven and earth. And some people think that because, you know, when you're up in the mountain, it's the closest place you get to heaven. That's not really the reason, okay? But some of you might be scratching your head right now. And it's not because you haven't shampooed for a while. But it's because you're wondering why a mountain is the meeting point of God and man. This doesn't make sense, right? Because if you have ever climbed a mountain, how many of you have ever climbed a mountain? Then you know it's not the best meeting place in the world, right? Why? Because there are no elevators going up. You know, it takes so long for you to get up there, and by the time you get up there, it's time to go down, right? So why a mountain? Let me explain this to a biblical writer's cosmology. All right, cosmology, that's a new word for somebody. And no, cosmology is not the study of makeups and lipsticks. It's not the study of cosmetics, okay? Cosmology actually means how a person understands and perceives the universe, all right? And one thing you have to know is that our cosmology today was very much, or is very much different from the cosmology of the Bible authors back then. Okay, let me explain this to you. Here is our modern day cosmology. Let's show this photo. Okay, you see this photo? This is the universe as seen from the Hubble Observatory. Okay, and in case you're wondering, the Hubble is actually not an ordinary telescope. In fact, it won't fit in your bare hands, and it won't even fit in your pocket, because the Hubble Observatory, or the Hubble Telescope, it floats deep in space, in outer space, that it can take photos of distant stars and other galaxies. So yeah, I'm actually waiting for a smartphone that can do this. Okay, here is another photo of our Milky Way galaxy. All right, this is taken by the Hubble. It's breathtaking, right? In the future, when traveling to space will be as easy as commuting from Quezon City to Makati, this is what Google Maps will look like, all right? They're going to call it Google Galaxy. Yeah, I'm already thinking of copywriting that so my great-great-great-great-grandchild can sell it to Google for $1 gajillion, all right? That's my idea. So this is our modern cosmology. This is what it looks like. This is what we know the universe to look like, all thanks to Edwin Hubble, you know, the guy who invented the Hubble telescope. So when you think about it, the ancient authors of the Bible who lived, you know, like 2,000, 3,000 years ago, they had a very different cosmology, because to them, the universe didn't look like what we see from the Hubble telescope today. You know, to them, it looked more like this, a snow globe. That's right, a snow globe. That's how the universe might have looked at them. And then imagine throwing this into a bucket of water. All right, let me explain. In the book of Genesis, God created the universe out of chaos, okay, which was symbolized by dark, raging waters. And then when God was finished creating, there were three tiers or levels, okay? There was water below the dome, and there was water above the dome, and it was all flat land in the middle, okay? That was their cosmology. That's how they perceived the universe. In fact, ancient humans believed that the earth was flat. You know, and somehow they believed that if you walked far enough, you would get to the edge of the world and you can jump off. In fact, some people still actually believe this conspiracy theory. But anyway, that's for another talk, okay? Why am I sharing this with you? Because by understanding the cosmology of the Bible writers when they wrote this, we can understand their language and most importantly, their spiritual message. Okay, let me give you this classic example, all right? Some people still like to ask the question about the book of Genesis. Like, you know, is the book of Genesis real? Well, is Adam and Eve real? Did they really exist? You know, did they really take a bite out of that apple? Was there really a serpent that talked? You know, here's the thing. You know, the reason why you have these questions about Genesis is because you might be reading it through modern day eyeglasses. You know, don't read it as if you're reading Harry Potter, where serpents actually spoke. Read it from the lens of the author. Because when the author wrote Genesis, you know, he wasn't writing a science book. No. Instead, he was writing a theology book. He was sharing his own experience with God during the Babylonian exile. Okay, so if you're reading Genesis looking for science, you know, you are going to be disappointed. You are actually doing it a great disservice. You're disrespecting the original intention of the author when he wrote it. I mean, think of it this way. Genesis is like this brand new, flaming red, 25 million Lamborghini. And then you're using it for Grab Express. That's what happens when you read the Bible using our modern cosmology. You know, when you're looking at it through the modern day eyeglasses. We said this before, that when you read the Bible, I want you to imagine as if you are both riding an airplane and going into a time machine, right? I mean, imagine this. When you go to France, you don't go to a restaurant and say, isang tapsilog nga po. No, you don't say that, right? Of course not. You're in France. Instead, you say, coca-vie, please. That's French for a French dish. Anyway, remember that the Bible is a totally different culture. So respect it and then value its strangeness. Okay? And not only that, you are traveling back thousands and thousands of years. All right? The cosmology will be very different. All right? You need to understand that their worldview so that you can better understand their message. All right? And hey, I know it's going to be difficult, but when you understand more what the Bible author is saying, here's what will happen. God's message will change you forever. That's what I'm hoping that will happen today. Okay? Let's talk about our first mountain. Okay? Everybody go to the book of Genesis. You don't need to go far because it's the first book in the Bible. Genesis chapter 2, verse 8. And it says, then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. Okay, some of you might be shocked. Garden of Eden is a mountain? Brother Bo is going to talk about this. And then it says, and there he placed the man he had made. Verse 9, the Lord God made all sorts of trees grow up from the ground, trees that were beautiful and that produced delicious fruit. And in the middle of the garden, he placed the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Verse 10, a river flowed from the land of Eden, watering the garden and then dividing it into four branches. Amen. Please welcome everybody, Brother Bo Sanchez.
Hi, everybody. God bless you. I am so happy to be at the feast with you. Today, my one big message is this. Are you ready? I hope your hearts are ready. Here it is. Receive God's blessing now. You have access. You have access. If there's a person beside you, tap that person and say, you have access. Type it in the chat. Say, you have access. Better yet, put your hand over your chest and declare this with me. Say this with faith, with conviction. I have access. Brother Bo, what does that mean? You'll find out in a while. But here, let me make an announcement first. Are you ready? The Garden of Eden is a mountain. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes. Brother Bo, how do you know? Well, the text that we just read, verse 10, what does it say? It says, a river flowed from the land of Egypt, watering the garden and then dividing into four branches. And then if you read the next few verses, it says that the river watered the nations. Now, I want you to think about that. Like wow, that's wild. Hey, if the Garden of Eden were not elevated, there would be no flowing down to the nations. None whatsoever. The second thing also that you notice when you read through scriptures, there are parts in the Bible that assumed that Eden was a mountain. But you see, if you are familiar with the Middle East, then it's a no-brainer. In the Middle East, gardens are connected to elevated places because the mountain, that's where the climate is cooler. That's when there's a lot of water. And then the plains below, mostly desert, mostly wilderness, etc. But the gardens are in the elevated places. So what is this? I got it. You know, Eden Mountain. Yeah, right. So what's the point? The point is this about the river flowing down from Eden to the nations. What's that? It is God's, I hope you're listening, Eden expansion project. This God's idea was, there's this beautiful garden and that's the world over there. His plan was this, to make that world a garden. Yes, there are deserts and yes, but he wanted the whole thing to be a garden. Brother Bo, that's amazing. What's our role there in that? Let me answer that question by answering another question. Because a lot of people ask me this, Brother Bo, Adam and Eve, are they real historical figures? I'll answer that question in this way. Are you ready? I'm going to respect the intention of the human author. The original intention of the human author of Genesis. And what's the intention? The intention is this, that what does Adam and Eve mean, by the way? Adam means humanity. Eve means life. Oh, his intentions were very clear from the start. Adam and Eve are us. Us, we're Adam and Eve. Now, friends, think with me. Very, very important. Okay, Brother Bo. So what's that? So here it is. In Genesis 1:28, it says, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it." My dear friends, we talked about God's Eden expansion project. Guess what? You're supposed to lead it. Adam and Eve, we're not just going to be the members of the Homeowners Association of Eden Subdivision. Yeah, no, they're supposed to be in charge of the garden. They're supposed to be co-rulers of this cosmic mountain. They are his kings and queens. And friends, this is the whole idea of creating man in his image and his likeness. We're supposed to represent God in this world. And that's why we need the tree of life. We need the tree of life. In the Garden of Eden, there were two trees, the tree of life and the tree of knowing good and bad. You're familiar with that? Okay. God gave Adam and Eve access, 100% access, total access to the tree of life. Which brings me to a little story I want to share with you that happened when I was 16 years old and I was traveling in Europe for 41 days all by myself. It's the first time I traveled out of the country, so I was crazy afraid and I had very little money. So little, I kept my money in my socks. Have you ever done that, like traveling with money in your socks? So that's what I did. My money was smelly but safe, okay? And to save money, for lunch, usually, I will look for a park bench, sit down there, grab my bread from my bag. I would have bread and banana and bread. I would go to a grocery store, buy a loaf of bread, buy 10 bananas, put it in my bag, good for 2 to 3 days. That's how I saved money. But when I was in Rome, I had a priest friend who was studying and I visited him. And I saw to it that I will visit him right before lunch. You know why. The bread and banana combo was getting old. So when he opened the door, he asked me a question that was music to my ears. He said, "We're about to have lunch. Have you eaten?" Yes, no. So anyway, he ushered me to the dining room, and I was at first shocked, you know, because there were 40 plus priests of different ages and nationalities. And lo and behold, this long buffet table with an endless array of Italian pizza and other dishes. It was, oh man! And anyway, so I took my first bite, you know, sat down, took my first bite, and my stomach asked my brain, "Is this food? It doesn't taste bread and banana." Just wanted to make you laugh. My priest friend, as we were eating, he pulled out something from his pocket and then he gave it to me. He said, "Take this." I took it. It was a key. It was a key. And I said, "What's this?" And he said, "It's the key, duplicate key of the front door. And anytime, come in. You're hungry? Come in." I don't know how I look. I probably look famished, like horribly, I don't know, malnourished. Anyway, he said, "Come in anytime, you know, morning, noon, evening, just come in and eat. It's there, kitchen." I thought I won the lotto. It's like I wanted to jump up and down. And I want you to know that this is the reason why I share you that story. It's because of this, that I really think that. Oh, by the way, I changed my itinerary. I was supposed to stay in Rome for 3 days. I stayed for 8 days, and I actually lived in his house already, so no need to go out. But that, isn't that what God did to Adam and Eve? There was this tree of life, and they could eat there at any time. This was the tree of life. Everything that they needed was in the tree of life. All the peace that they needed, all the joy was there. All the happiness that they needed was there. All the wisdom was there. All the strength was there. All the blessings was there. It was all available. Question, did they actually eat from the tree of life? Genesis is silent about that. Not a hint. Not a squeak. They did not say. You cannot read in the book of Genesis this story where Adam and Eve walked to the tree of life, got a fruit, nibbled it, and said, "This is freaking delicious. What's my name? Who am I? This is so..." You know, none. And I think it was intentional. I really think that the Genesis writer was saying, this is a perfect picture of our stupidity, because they did not go to the tree of life. They went to the tree of knowing good and bad. Now, what's the deal with that tree? We've said this in the feast a few times. Refresh your memory. The tree of knowing good and bad, the other tree that Adam and Eve went to, that represents man's attempt at redefining good and bad for ourselves apart from God. It is man taking matters into his own hands, not trusting God. At the end of the day, two trees is a question of trust. God is asking you today, will you trust me? Or will you redefine good and bad and take matters? Will you trust me? And I wanna ask this question. Why did Adam and Eve not eat from the tree of life? Why? I'll tell you. Fear? I think it's fear. That's my guess. Why? Is the tree of life scary, Brother Bo? It represents God's divine presence. And yeah, it could be awe-striking and terrifying. To bring you back to that story of mine, crazy story when I was 16, when the priest gave me the key, I felt joy, but I also felt fear because I had to deal with these 40 priests who were mostly tall Europeans who were speaking French and Italian and German and other languages. And who was I? I felt small. I was a 16-year-old poor Filipino. You know, why? I'm not supposed to be there. But thanks be to God, my hunger was greater than my fear. greater than my shame. And I pray that right now your hunger for God is stronger and greater than your shame. God bless you. You have access.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Bo. What a beautiful reminder. You have access. I want to take it home today by, you know, giving some more parts of the talk, and let's sing one more reflection song as we end. And I want to go to the point and remind you that, you know, we know that we have access. We remind that we have access here, but let's not take the easy path. I want to read it from Genesis 3:6. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. So this was the easy path. This one, you know, putting things under my control, under my authority. And sadly, when we do that in life, it ends up with death. We lose access to the abundance of Eden. We, you know, because of what Adam and Eve did, this beautiful garden, this mountain garden was ruined. And here's the warning from the Genesis story today. At first glance, the tree of knowing good and bad looked beautiful, but it kills. When at first glance, when something looks nice, something looks great, something, sometimes if we are not so discerning, it could kill us. It could kill our dreams, our relationships, our bodies. The tree of life, however, may have looked terrifying, but it heals. Friend, when you look at the cross, the tree of life, it heals. It may look terrifying because it may symbolize death, but Jesus resurrected and now it symbolizes new life. Let's not take the easy path. There is a cross that we need to carry every single day. Because of our sin, because the Eden expansion project that Brother Bo was talking about, it was halted. Man was deported from Eden. Sayang, from the garden, they could no longer eat from the tree of life. Sayang, nandun na ang saya na sana. But in the middle of this dark situation, that's how God works. Even in darkness, even in absence of hope, God works. God gave them hope. And while talking to the snake, God said, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. And he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. Someone comes to mind. Let me explain this a little bit. This is like a mysterious verse. And God said that the seed of this woman was going to undo the effects of the sin. This seed will crush the root of all evil, but in the process, he will also be struck by it. Galing, no? Again and again, you will find this beautiful hope all throughout the Old Testament about the coming of someone special who will, you know, who will do what Israel failed to do, represent God in the world. And there is a Savior coming. Like now we're in Advent, we are in hope that the joy of the world is coming. When we redefine good and bad for ourselves, we really experience death. We lost access to God's garden. But through Jesus, all is not lost. For Isaiah the prophet, he said, from Isaiah 25, verse 6 to 8, on this mountain, remember, the mountain of Eden, we lost access. But in the other parts, in the later parts of the Old Testament, Israel was hoping. And there is this hope. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meat, the finest of wines. God is preparing our re-entry to the garden, to the hope, to the abundance, And on this mountain, I'm emphasizing this, on this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. And he will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. Do you know where Jesus was crucified? It was on a mountain. Calvary symbolized death. Because Calvary now is the new Eden. And Jesus was crucified on a tree, on a piece of wood, the cross, because Jesus is the new tree of life. That's our hope. And as Christians, we believe this hope. We have this hope that does not disappoint. Jesus was the mysterious seed that Genesis talked about. After he died like a seed, he was buried. And after 3 days, it sprung out. Third day, he burst forth out of the ground. And there's the new life, the new tree of life for us all. My friends, the reminder is this. Jesus is the key. Jesus is our access. So we could come in. We could join the feast. We could live in abundance. Come, ascend the mountain of the Lord, because Jesus is the key. Jesus is our access, and you and I have Jesus.
It is so beautiful to be in the presence of God. And can we pray right now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit? I want you just to lift up to Him all your needs. Whatever you're going through, He knows what you're going through. He knows where you're coming from. He knows the burdens of your heart. Just bring it up to God and say, Lord, I surrender everything, that all hurt and all pain and all worries and all fear. Lift them all up to you, Lord. I surrender them to you. You are my King, and you are the center of my life, and I trust you, and I know that you are blessing me right now. I receive your love. I receive your joy. I receive your peace. I receive your healing. I receive your provision in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Thank you so much for joining me today. Live a fantastic life.